Hello everyone, how are you after this long day? This is the final presentation of the day, I think, on this stage, so I hope you're not tired. I think this presentation is a little bit different compared to the other presentations you've seen today. I'm going to talk about DreamHack. DreamHack is world's largest computer festival, but we have actually changed the name a little bit and call ourselves Digital Festival, because we don't see that PC or computers in general is the platform we need to have to produce our events. I'm head of esports, and it sounds maybe funny to have a head of esports, but we're a small company, 17 people, and I have a team with 5 people only working with esports tournaments in computer games. I'm going to talk a little bit about DreamHack, but also talk about how games is becoming a spectator sport. And it's also going to challenge traditional sports, in my opinion, within the upcoming 5-10 years, maybe. So first of all, I'm going to tell the story about DreamHack. DreamHack started '94, so we're actually celebrating 20 years next winter, which is in November. So it started in '94 by two guys. You can see them here on the slide, Martin and Kenny, two computer enthusiasts. This was almost before the World Wide Web. So they gathered 40 people in a very small school cafeteria in the northern part of Sweden. The main reason was, of course, to meet friends. It was one of the first really organized LAN parties. You brought your computer to the school cafeteria, stayed there for 4 days. And I think that the main activity was, of course, a lot of different stuff. But the cool thing was probably the demo part of it, where you create either your code. Back then it was creating only demos, but it was also graphics and music. And they challenged each other, and after each event, you could win something if you turned out to be the fan favorite or the event favorite. And I don't think they realized where DreamHack ended up in the last place, but we were 40 people when it all started. And the growth was actually amazing the upcoming year. So as you can see, it's kind of small, but next year it was 80 people. The year after it was 120. 750, and it's basically double the size every year. And now, this year, we have 42,000 almost visitors. And the important piece of history here is a little bit that 2002 we expanded to 2 events. So we have DreamHack Summer and DreamHack Winter. And also the last 3 years we have expanded internationally. To a little bit explain what DreamHack is. I mean, it's a festival. You can see here on the picture, you bring your own computer. You stay there for 4 days, 24/7. We give everyone that's coming a sleeping space. It's like an indoor camping. I think it's very similar to any music festival or any other festival, but it's quite different theme since it's gaming. It's one of Sweden's largest youth festivals today, and we still have the Guinness World Record for being world's largest computer festival. And we actually have stopped to get more records because there's nobody else challenging our record. We have two, I would say, friends, one in Finland, which is Assembly, and in Norway we have Gathering. And there is, of course, a couple of smaller LAN parties even in the Baltics. But there's no one that have reached the same size as DreamHack. And just to give you a clue, we have exactly the same size of the hall, three halls of this LAN. So it's 44,000 square meters that we use to host this. And to a little bit give the feeling about the DreamHack experience, it's, as I said, open 24/7. There's no alcohol, no drugs. That's also because we have no age limit, so you can come there if you're 12 or 13. Actually, a lot of fathers is bringing their sons, even if they are 10, 11. And we have changed the festival the last years a lot. So as you can see here, we in the different halls, we have the LAN party, but nowadays we have stages, we have an expo, It's also a lot of music on the stage. Some of the most famous Swedish artists are playing on the stage. We also have film lectures. So it's quite different event today. It's more like a festival. We also have around 700 volunteers that are actually producing this event. And some of our volunteers have been working for 10 to 12 years with DreamHack. So they're getting older and older. And most of the people is actually working for Cisco or Microsoft or other companies full time. And they do this on their vacation. So we have a great help from them. But I think it's a little bit hard to explain DreamHack without showing a video. So I'm going to show a short video, just a little bit to give the feeling how the event is, and you can a little bit understand a little bit the atmosphere. See if there's some sound, maybe. It's not. Pause it, maybe. Yes. Hopefully we get some sound. If not, amazing pictures. It's probably my computer that's... We can do it silent. I can explain. There you see the main hall. This is one of our esport halls where we show matches. This is the main stage, where we have all the music acts, but also the opening ceremony. Some of the media production we're doing. Some of the professional players playing at different tournaments, StarCraft, Dota 2. Seems we don't get the sound, so it's, I feel like a live commentator. Some of the champions in the different tournaments, League of Legends, as you could see there. Street Fighter, StarCraft 2. These guys that you're going to see now, Fnatic, won $100,000 in our Counter-Strike tournament. And that's an Estonian Dota 2 star, Puppy, that won a lot of money as well in Dota 2. And here's Teja, that won our StarCraft 2 competition. And there we have it. So no sound. It would be a much cooler experience with the sound, I promise you.
There is an exception about the alcohol.
No, that's actually Swedish pommack, which is an alcohol-free version of champagne. So it's not alcohol. On the other events we produce, not on the festivals, we have real stuff, but that's alcohol-free actually. Now I'm going to change subject a little bit. We missed the video, we missed the sound a little bit, but I think you at least could see on the pictures what's going on. And what we realized 2007 was that people didn't want to play tournaments only, they want to basically see the tournaments. So we started to build stages, basically for esport matches, for competitive gaming. And we started really small with probably an arena like this, and suddenly we used the biggest auditorium, which was 1,000 people. And we realized also that people were starting to buy tickets to DreamHack only to watch games, not to participate or play games, but to watch our different tournaments. So this was a big change for our company, because today we half of our company is basically working with esports and only this, and it was all started at our DreamHack events. And we also started to basically export this format. So first we did an event in Stockholm with 500 people in the Culture House, which is in the middle of Stockholm. The year after we did in Annexet, which is a bigger hall. We got 1,500 people only buying tickets to watch esports. And as you can see here, you have the players on stage. We also do the interviews with the players in front of the crowd. And it's almost like a sports experience, but very different. And you can see the matches on the big projection screen. And the year after, we went to an ice hockey arena and got 3,000 people that just went to this event to watch the matches. Didn't get anything else than actually watching the tournament, not play any games or anything like that. And we realized that esports is something that's it's very connected to how gaming works and all that, but it also takes the best parts, in my opinion, from normal sports where people go here to cheer for their favorites, to see their idols and maybe the most famous caster, the most famous players. And most of the time, to experience esports live on site is something very different to watch it online or on TV. So the year after, a dream come true for us because we rented the national indoor arena in Sweden. We didn't use all the space because it actually fits, I think, 13,000 people in that arena, but we used half of it and we got 4,000 people buying tickets, and the tickets were kind of expensive, 35 euros. And this was an iconic event for us and our esport development, because renting this arena is a little bit like renting Madison Square Garden in New York, but this is Sweden. Here is where you, for example, play the World Championship in ice hockey and all these other sports. So it's very like iconic building back home in Sweden. And we realized that now we have a new category of events, which is not our LAN parties, our festivals, and it's very different actually to what we do in our festival events, because the target group is slightly different, depending on game, of course. But for StarCraft, for example, the normal guy is between 25 to 30 that's actually watching. The majority is that. And on our festivals, it's maybe 18 to 19. And I think if we would change game here, this was a StarCraft event. If we would have changed to League of Legends, for example, it would be lower, of course. But we can basically attract the fan base of that game, but also to create a slightly different event. And it works really well in big cities like Stockholm or, let's say, Vilnius. I think it would work as well, because it's a very different event where you don't need to commit so much time. You don't need to sit there for 4 days. You can just have a nice evening. And when we created these stage shows, we also had to start to produce more and more content and also create a production arm around DreamHack that's only producing esports, because we talked to all these TV companies and said, we want to put this on TV and we want to make esports something really, really big. And of course they listened, but I think the people that answered the call was probably not the right guys. So we tested them a little bit, and then after that we basically used our DreamHack style, which is a little bit do-it-yourself. So we learned how to produce TV, and today we, on our big festivals, we're almost 150 people that are only producing these matches. And at the same time, live streaming in HD got very accessible and cheap to all these services, as you might know, Twitch, for example, which is the YouTube of esports, but for live content. And you have all these other services that popped up at the same time. So DreamHack TV, after seeing proof of concept that people can go to an event and experience live esports, we created this production arm basically to, you know, take that audience or make that audience even bigger and give this content to basically a global audience instead of just Swedish viewers. And now I have a video, so I'm not sure we should actually play it, because I don't think the sound is going to work. So I'm jumping that. Maybe we can try as the last piece of this presentation. But looking at that part, when we created the DreamHack TV, we also saw that the stream viewers increased heavily. So for example, this year we had around 9 million unique viewers and also around 36 million started streams, which is comparable to other media outlets. It's very, very good. And this is only live viewers, so there's no VOD viewers here. So this is live, and we can be peaking at our big events, maybe at 450,000 concurrent viewers on all our games. And looking a little bit more at our streaming numbers, we think the most important part compared to normal TV is that people are watching longer and longer. Now the average time looking at all our tournaments is 100 minutes per unique session, which is really, really good compared to traditional TV, for example, especially commercial channels, is much lower. And at the same time, we did this development and transformed as a company. The same thing happened at other places around the world. Our biggest competitors is probably MLG in US, ESL in Germany, and GOM2E in Korea. And looking at all the tournaments, for example, the growth has been amazing, especially the last 3 years, as you could see. And it was a turning point at 2010. It was all the first time HD live streaming got very accessible and cheap, but also a few big games basically was released, or at least a beta was released, StarCraft, League of Legends, and a couple of other games that really pushed the game into mainstream and had a esport focus from the beginning. But of those 12 million dollars we are giving out, almost I think 1 million. So we're a small piece of that. And right now, we run 3 different esport projects. We have DreamHack Open, which is a tour that's go across Europe. We're in Valencia, we're in Moscow, and a lot of other cities, Bucharest as well. It's a European championship, as we call it. We're running a Swedish championship back home in Sweden with 8 qualifier events. And the new property we started, the highest, which is a Dota 2 league, that actually is an online league that we broadcast from Stockholm. I'm going to tell more about that. So we try to a little bit not create the normal sport structure that you see in maybe football or ice hockey or any other game. We try to find, or basically try to create stuff that are maybe for a more new modern target group. And of course, it helps to call it European Championship, but we use DreamHack Open, for example. And it's the same with Dream League. You can call it an international league, but we try to brand everything as something new and not compare it too much with traditional sports. Because esports doesn't really have any federation or anything like that right now. Looking at the map, we have expanded internationally the last couple of years, and we're in Valencia, Bucharest, and soon Moscow as well, and we're about to expand to the western part of Europe as well. Looking a little bit at the trends, I've been talking about it already, and I think the most important trend is that video games is becoming a bigger and bigger part of your everyday life. I mean, you go to school, you go to work, and then you have a locked time of spare time every evening. And of that part, the piece of the spare time, gaming is becoming more and more important. That's something you can see in all studies and researches. Also, we see that the gamers when we do our surveys and talk to the gamers around DreamHack, they're not watching TV anymore, not that much compared to the rest of the population, especially in Sweden. So they choose live streaming. That's why most of the traditional media partners we work with back home in Sweden, they use the DreamHack content basically to attract the younger demographics to their video player and not to maybe have something really cool on their TV channel. It's more to basically not miss a young target group that are not watching TV anymore. So gaming is and especially esports is a perfect entertainment for that. And the third trend I see, which is really interesting for us as well, is that game publishers is leaving this old Hollywood model where you basically produce a game for 2 years maybe, and then you have a big release, you put all your marketing money, all your resources into release a game, and they are now more using the game to maybe have a service and create new business models like free to play, free to pay, and all the different models there is, freemium, call it whatever you want. And I think the game publishers love to talk about this because they want to basically find the perfect model for releasing games. And this is a trend that's kind of changing the whole gaming industry right now. And we think it's a good thing because the game publishers need to have a closer relationship with their fans and with the gamers. And I think that's a trend that's changing the landscape, especially for us, but for basically everyone in the industry. And I think another important trend and what we see is that esport is not replacing traditional sports, because most of the esport fans that we are following is also watching traditional sports. They're either hockey fans or football fans or love MMA or something else. So it's more that esports is offering something completely new. It's offering something both as a gamer but also as a spectator, because if you just compare it, watching a football game, for example, the spectator knows the same things as the players or the players on the pitch. But in esports, it's kind of more interesting to actually follow the drama, because if you're watching a StarCraft game, for example, you know more than the players, because usually the players have not a total view of the map, and as a player you can see how the story unfolds, and a little bit if one player is really behind in one game, you can really see that, even though that player doesn't know that he's behind, you can see that, and if he do an amazing move or an amazing strategy, the impact for you as a viewer is much greater than watching, let's say, a traditional sport where everything is very expected, and you can also the players on site react and understand or can see stuff in the same way as you. Another thing with esports is that you also have a possibility to include features in the games that's actually directed directly to the viewers. For example, with Twitch TV, I know that they are working on features that where you can basically right now you have chat where you can chat about the game, but in the future maybe you can actually interact with the games or with the competition, and that's kind of interesting. So looking a little bit forward, what we have done, and tomorrow at 9 o'clock, Simon here is talking about our partnership with MTGX. We realized that it doesn't really matter how many events we produce every year, because we can't create more and more esport content, and the demand is huge. So we created a studio in Stockholm. We built it for 4 months, which is I would say a professional TV studio. I can show you a picture real fast. Where we produce esports only. So we don't have the gamers here. All the gamers are sitting at home competing. And from this studio, we're producing matches. And here you can see our biggest property, which is Dream League, with 4 experts standing in a desk commentating the Dota 2 tournament. And we created this studio basically to go from 29 days of broadcast to, in the future, 290 days. That's an ambitious goal. And it's going to probably take 2 years or something like that. But already this year, we're going to reach 150 days. So I think the progress is there. And the other big thing we're doing is that we're expanding outside of Sweden much more. We're looking at France, UK, and Benelux. But we're also looking at expanding outside Europe. And our CEO, which is a very funny and strange guy. He has a goal that we should host the first LAN party on the moon. but it's more a funny goal than actually a realistic, I guess. But we're looking to expand the DreamHack event, because our goal with the DreamHack brand is basically to, people have called us the digital Woodstock, but we want to be that important part of the new digital generation that grows up, and be that event where you can basically have an outlet for all your interests, including esports, but also programming and other internet-related content. And there's the studio again. And then I'm a little bit wrapping this presentation up. If we can't show the video later on, then I have two videos to show. But this is like the most important picture we have at DreamHack, because this is what it's all about right now for us. We want to make what from outside looks like gaming nerds and people that are, you know, maybe not that social or maybe shy. The stars of the future sports, and if you think about it, it's kind of interesting, because most of the hockey and football players, they're also very, at least the most successful. I always refer to ice hockey, so it's kind of bad maybe in Lithuania, but Peter Forsberg, for example, which is one of the most accomplished Swedish hockey players. I mean, in his life, from 5 years old until 18, he basically only played ice hockey. Otherwise, he wouldn't be the best. It's basically impossible to be the best in the world if you're not playing enough. And when he did his first interviews and met media in Sweden, back home then when he was 18, of course he was shy. He didn't, he couldn't, you know, present himself to media in general. Now, if you look at him, for example, when after being in NHL in America and 10 years after, he could, you know, walk into any TV show anywhere and basically talk to Jay Leno or whatever and don't have a problem with it. It's a little bit the same thing with esports stars. They, of course, shy because they have dedicated their, not their life, but often 3-4 years of their life of just playing this game to become the best. That's why this image is really important, because what we're trying to do is basically to put these guys into a context where they feel comfortable talking to media, get fans, and basically become the idols of the new era. And what we can see with these guys, this is Stardust, for example, he's a bad example, but many of these guys were really shy the first time they walked on the stage, but after a few events, they basically own the stage. They are more convenient than pop stars, I would say. And they are walking out there, raising their hands and just get the love from the audience. And it would be good if you could show the video, because then if you haven't seen it, you would realize that this is something extraordinary. Yeah. We do a test if we can show the video. This is our latest trailer for DreamHack.
I still remember the crowd roaring his name. Thank you.
Woohoo! So if you look at this video, and my, I was going to give you an example. My mother is kind of old. She's 68. And I never invited her to any DreamHack event. And I've been working at DreamHack for 6 years. And before that, I've been to LAN parties, or, you know, a lot of times. And she's completely, she's not interested in esports at all. She haven't used a computer except at work. And I invited her to one of these events. And when she can see the players on stage and see the emotions and see how the audience reacts, and she have this old traditional picture that this is not sports, this is nothing. When she sees that, she directly, you know, changed her mind over 2 minutes. It's kind of interesting. And that's kind of important when we're in the early stage here to produce, to make something really big, is that esports, as soon as you have seen it live or on a live stream, you're going to see that this is as competitive as any other sport. And the people that are playing it, they play it 8 hours a day, basically, to be the best. And it's impossible to not be the best in any sport if you don't play 8 hours a day. So it's an interesting development. So with that said, I don't think I have a lot more to add. It's a little bit the story about DreamHack, but also what we're doing with esports as a spectator sport and how we want to develop it in the future. And if you have any questions or anything to say. Yeah. We have some online questions at least. Yeah, we start with you, then we take this. Me personally? From the beginning, Counter-Strike only. Now I play Dota 2, StarCraft 2, and Counter-Strike. And then, I mean, these are the games that I play every day. Then, of course, I play new games and stuff that are released. But the problem with the lifespan of those games is it's fun for 4 weeks, and then you're not that interested. So I play all the new games almost. And you? Yes, I mean, usually the first step is that you become a volunteer. And we have a completely open crew system, and now we have converted everything into English as well. So we have a lot of people coming from Denmark, Norway, Estonia, someone. We have a couple of Americans coming, and we have 700 people. But basically, you need to either have a recommendation or you have to apply and get approved or accepted. And then you get a lot of stuff for being volunteer as well, like free food and stuff, t-shirts. But that's the start, and many crew use that as a way to maybe work more in gaming or work more with DreamHack. And we have around 40 to 50 people that we hire and pay for producing our events outside the festival. So I can take this question from online. Is there any chance for a big esport event to take place in Lithuania? Yes, I think so. I mean, we had the first idea actually for this conference was, instead of going here talking about it, was actually to have a mini tournament here, just here, with one player from the Baltic countries and one player from Sweden, just because DreamHack is from Sweden. But it didn't happen this time, maybe next year. But I think the potential in the Baltic countries is huge, and that's why we right now is in. We're right now only in Bucharest and Moscow, but we are really focused on the Eastern Europe because that's where gaming and especially esports is the strongest right now, and the development is going forward the fastest. Question? I mean, we have League of Legends at our big events, DreamHack Summer and Winter. League of Legends is the most popular game right now, but Riot, which is the publisher, is very protective, and they are running their own leagues online, so it's kind of tricky sometimes to run League of Legends as an online league, as we do in Dota 2, for example. But we feature, I mean, we have a partnership with Riot, and we have last DreamHack Summer, we had the League of Legends Championship Series at DreamHack. So we produce stuff in League of Legends, absolutely. In gaming, I think other people here can answer better, probably. I don't have the stats. I think in Sweden, if you look at all platforms, including mobile and web games and stuff like that, it's, I wouldn't say 50-50, but it's a huge piece of the pie that's actually women. And I think it's 60-40 or something like that. I don't remember the exact stats. But our events, it's kind of interesting because the traditional LAN experience, when you go there with your own computer, that's been very male-focused because it's coming from a nerd culture in the 90s where it was mostly the guys that had computers in their home. That piece is 3 years, 4 years ago, it was 5% women that actually bought a LAN ticket. Now it's around 10, so it's changing right now. And if we look at all the other tickets, like day pass, event pass, and also visiting these esport events, I would say that we don't have the exact statistics because some of the events we use external ticket system, but I would say it's closer to 20%. So it's changing, and I think with more and more girls, for example, having access to a computer from early age and also have games developed only for them, or let's say at least focused on that part, it's going to change on our events as well. Yeah.
How do you choose the game?
Yeah. That's actually the hardest part. And that's something I can't even answer when a publisher asked me. It's so many factors. I mean, of course, it's how the game is built from the beginning. Is it made for competitive gaming? And that includes, I mean, it has to be balanced and it has to be fair. You can't have a game where, let's say, you have one unit that's completely imbalanced and it's, you know, too good. Because it's very hard to have fair competition in a game where it's not, you know, at least some kind of balanced mechanics. It's also the other part is basically what we look a lot at is to get this grassroots community from the beginning. I mean, it's hard to describe how you get that, and as a game publisher, how you really accomplish it. But we don't pick a game only because of a publisher telling us to pick it. We're looking how many sites is it, how many forums, how much activity is going around this game. It can be small, but it has to be a core community around it, because those are the players we are using as the players in the tournament, but also as admins, as people helping producing the tournament. So we need to have a core community. And I would say that the third part is probably how good is the game to spectate. I mean, some games even today, 2014, is not even built with a spectator mode, which is insane right now when you look at the market and look how esport is developing. I think Battlefield 4, which is a Swedish game, they had spectator mode now on the latest version, which is 1 year old, and it took them 10 years from the first to get that. So spectator mode is really, really important, and it has to be a good spectator mode as well, so you can really follow the matches. And a good example of that is maybe Counter-Strike GO now, Counter-Strike Global Offensive, that have been a bad game for spectating, but with some changes from the game developers, it's now a really easy game to follow. So that's the three core components if you talk to a game publisher, or let's say that part. Of course, it's some other stuff added to the mix as well. I mean, can you get sponsors? Can you is media interested of this game and stuff like that? I would say it's a little bit 50-50. I think the coolest setup is what we do with Dota 2 right now, is that we and the sponsors are putting up $100,000. And then all the fans can buy an in-game item, which is called the League Compendium, in the actual game. And the fans have raised another $100,000 now, so we have $200,000 in prize money. So that says a little bit, that's a really good setup, because then we get help to have an even bigger prize pool. And especially good for the teams, because the teams can earn more because of the fans supporting it. But in general, I would say it's 50-50. Some games we are supporting the prize pool completely, and some other games publishers are helping with that part. What games has the most potential right now? I mean, it's changing all the time, and I think it's a good question. I would say that the new Blizzard games is really promising, both Hearthstone and in the future Heroes of Storm is the right name. I would say I think everyone is waiting for a new FPS game, because Counter-Strike is a little bit, it's a new game, but it's still an old IP and an old franchise, and both Call of Duty and Battlefield haven't been, I mean, they are releasing game every year, so it's hard to create an esport community around a game that's changing every year. It's a little bit like changing the football pitch to, I don't know, to a complete new pitch every year, so all the professionals need to relearn how to, you know, score goals. It's kind of important to have a game that, and that's why free-to-play is so important right now for esports, because then the publisher are more interested to support the game every day and patch it every month and take care of their customers, instead of, for example, games where you just release it and don't care about the game, because esport games probably need the most patches there is, because the balance are changing depending on how the players are using and playing the game. I think that's it. If you want to talk to me, I'm going to stick around probably 20 more minutes or something like that. So if you don't have any other questions, I'm happy to be here and answer your questions after. Thank you.